Family and friends, it's prayer time, and we want to be ever mindful to pray for our loved ones who are going through difficult times. It might be someone you know that's going through some trouble during this time of pandemic, but we want to be ever mindful to pray for our congregations, to pray for our communities, and to pray for our country, that God will still move in a mighty way. So let us go to the throne of grace this morning. Will you please join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we come to you with thanksgiving and praises because you've seen us safely through the night and you have wakened us at the blessing of your morning light. Heavenly Father, we thank you for a good portion of health and strength. We thank you that we're clothed in our right minds. We thank you for every step we make that brings us closer to you, God. We thank you for giving us this day our daily bread. We thank you for the canopy of protection over our heads. God, we thank you for our families. We thank you for our friends. We thank you for making ways out of no ways. We thank you for being a loving God. But God, there are people that are going through difficult times today, dear God. So God, we pray that you will go into each home, dear God. Go into each hospital, dear God. Go throughout the world, dear God, and lay a healing touch on everybody in the hospital or wherever they may be, dear God. God, we pray that you would heal the sick in the name of Jesus, God. God, we pray that you would mend broken homes and broken hearts, dear God. God, we ask you to be with everyone who is depressed and feeling lonely today, dear God. God, be with them. Give them peace that surpasses all understanding, dear God. God, we pray for those who are financially unstable, dear God. Those who are not working and can't see their way through, God. We know, dear God, that you are a provider and that you will supply just what they need, dear God. So, God, we thank you for sustaining them, for blessing them, for you know what they need, God. Great Father, we ask you to send guidance into the government, dear God. Send your guidance into the school system, dear God. And send guidance into the churches, dear God. As we continue, dear God, to look to you for all the answers, dear God. God, keep us covered in the blood of Jesus Christ. Bless us to be a blessing. Help us learn, dear God, to live right in your sight, God. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. This morning's scripture comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 13 through 21. Again, Matthew, 14th chapter, verses 13 through 21. The word of the Lord. Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for them." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. Last verse. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen.
Let us all enjoy God's word through song as Dr. Darrell Pope blesses us. through singing.
My Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done, he groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut its glories in, when God the mighty Maker died for his own creature's sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of tears can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen. From the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 18, in verse number 27, Jesus said, "What is impossible for mortals is possible for God. What is impossible for humans is possible with God." This morning, I would like to preach to you from the topic, the God of possibilities, the God of possibilities. Will you please join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, I ever so humbly pray that the words that will come out of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. God, you're my strength, you're my rock, and my redeemer. In Jesus' name I humbly pray. Amen. My sisters and brothers, Mother Teresa was a Roman Catholic nun who devoted her life to serving the poor and destitute around the world. She spent many years in Calcutta, and it wasn't surprising when Mother Teresa received the Nobel Peace Prize. True to form, she received the award in the name of the hungry, the naked, the homeless, the blind, and the lepers, all those who feel unwanted, unloved, uncared for, and throughout society. Those were the people she ministered to most of her life. And as we heard in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 through 21, which was read, Jesus modeled how to care for and love the marginalized regardless of their circumstances. We know that if something is given once in the Bible, it is usually true, and we should believe it. But when the Holy Spirit repeats itself, there must be a lesson of surpassing importance in this book. There is one miracle and only one that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all record. I refer to, of course, the story of feeding of the 5,000. I want to focus on just one detail of the story. When the great multitude came to Jesus in the wilderness, he was moved with compassion because he saw that they were tired and hungry. Late in the day, his disciples suggested that he send the people home so they could get something to eat for themselves. But in Mark chapter 6, verse 37 through 35, it tells us what happened next. When the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, This is a deserted place, and already the hour is late. The disciples said, send them away, that they may go into surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. But Jesus answered and said to them, you give them something to eat. You know the rest of the story and how they found a young lad with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and how Jesus blessed the meager lunch so that it could feed 5,000 men. That includes women and children, and that left even 12 baskets left over. This is one of the great miracles of the Bible. Imagine that, 5,000 hungry men. Can you imagine that for yourself? 5,000 hungry men that will show up uninvited to your house. Can you imagine that? That 5,000 hungry men needed something to eat. Can you imagine buying 5,000 deep dish pizza from Chicago, a Chicago style pizza? Can you imagine that when 5,000 men showed up, that they were so hungry that you didn't know what to do because the Burger King down the street was closed from remodeling? And of course, then you have Pizza Hut. Pizza Hut didn't deliver in Jerusalem in the wilderness. But if you think about it, disciples made some practical suggestions to send them away, because their suggestion meant that it wasn't that they had bad motives. It's that they knew that it was kind of logical because the disciples had no resources to meet this enormous need. They had no food. They had no money. What else? They just didn't have any answer for 5,000 hungry people. They didn't see, but this is what the disciples saw. They didn't just only see 5,000 hungry people. They saw 5,000 people, and they saw 5,000 problems. They saw 5,000 problems they had to solve, and they didn't know what to do. But I stopped by to tell you this morning that we are told that nothing is impossible for God. All too often, we conclude that something can't be done, so we don't bother trying to do it. John's account of this miracle tells us that it was Andrew who found the young boy with the 5 loaves and 2 fish and brought him to Jesus. We should not miss the obvious lesson here. Don't ever despise the day of small things. Just because something is small or seems insignificant, that doesn't mean that God cannot use a small situation. He used a baby's tears to attract Pharaoh's daughter, and the infant Moses was saved from the certain death. Later, he used Moses and a rod to deliver the children of Israel. And still later, he used a teenage young boy named David with 1 smooth stone to defeat a giant named Goliath. Now, Jesus is about to feed 5,000 men with 5 biscuits and 2 pieces of fish. I stopped by to tell you, size does not matter with God. He can use anything we have to offer. So I will submit to you 3 different lessons when we're understanding that the God of possibilities can do anything. Lesson number 1, the fact that something is impossible is no excuse for not trying to do it. All too often we conclude that something can't be done, so we don't bother trying to do it. If Moses had taken that attitude, the Jews would still be in Egypt. If Joshua had felt that way and taken that attitude, the walls of Jericho would still be standing. If David adopted that attitude, Goliath would still be terrorizing the Israelites. You never know in advance what God may do. So don't rule out the possibility of a miracle coming your way. All it takes is some faith, some belief, and some type of compassion. Jesus was moved with a strong affection to all of those people who were hurting, all those people who were hungry. My brothers and sisters, no matter what you're going through today, no matter what your family member or friend is going through today, remember that Jesus cares for you. He is ready to fill your life with impossibilities because nothing is impossible with God. I submit to you lesson number 2. God asks us to do the impossible, and then he gives us whatever we need to obey his command. A great writer named Edwin Lutzer points that Jesus often told people to do impossible things. In other words, Jesus told a lame man, rise up, pick up your bed and walk. He told a dead man to get up, and he cried out, Lazarus, come forward. There is a sense in which every command of God has a sense of impossibilities for us to obey, but we always lack what we need to obey God's command. But God is faithful to give us whatever we need when we ask him to. What God demands is when God demands, he supplies. As a matter of fact, when he tells us something, he always make a way out of no way. In other words, God can shatter the point-sized expectations of what we think is insignificant. In other words, little is much when God is in it. When Christians are willing to offer their lives sacrificially and to replenish and be of service to the world, there's no reason that we can make a difference in this world. All it takes is a little time. All it takes is a little bit of our talents. All it takes is a little bit of our treasures, our money, to make things happen. God will use ordinary things to create extraordinary things. All we have to do is just to have faith and have compassion. Jesus had faith. Jesus had compassion. He was moved to help those people out in the wilderness. I guess when you think about it, extraordinary and ordinary, God can use anything that you may have. He took two fish and five loaves of bread. What the people thought was ordinary, what the disciples thought was ordinary, he made an extraordinary feast. There are always some ordinary resources that we may have that we may think insignificant, but God can take those ordinary resources and make them extraordinary. But all we have to do is just step out on faith and launch out onto the deep and believe that miracles still happen today. And lesson number three, when we offer our meager resources to God, we discover that the impossible isn't. Years ago, I ran across a quote from J. Hudson Taylor, a great man of faith whose missionary efforts helped open China to the gospel. Time and time again, he saw God do amazing things in the face of hopeless circumstances, in the face of murderous circumstances, in the face of hostility. And reflected on his experience, he remarked that there are always three stages in any work when you attempt to do God's work. Number one, the first stage is impossible. The enemy wants you to believe that it's impossible to be done. Then the enemy wants to say it's difficult, that we cannot feed 5,000. We cannot have church back to normal. Your health cannot be back to normal. Your finances cannot be back to normal. And the third thing is done. In other words, I am very encouraged by that because there are many moments when we all seem to be stuck on the impossible stage of life. But all we have to do is look up, cheer up. You never know when God will take something impossible and make it possible. No matter what you're going through today, your finances might not be what it needs to be. All things are possible through God. Your health might not be what you think it needs to be. All things are possible with God. Your family might be going through some difficult times, but all things are possible with God. With man, it is impossible. With God, it is possible. The teachings of, as I conclude, the teachings of Mother Teresa teaches us that God has created us for great things, to love, to be tender, to be kind. God has called us to help each other. People in this world are still hungry, but one thing is for sure, they're not hungry just for food, but they're hungry for the word. They're hungry for something, encouragement. John Wesley put it this way, do all the good you can to all the people you can as long as you can. But he also says, give all you can. That means give your treasures, help somebody out. Do something with your funds if you can. This is how Jesus often works with his followers. Over and over again, he puts us in positions where it seems like it's a helpless situation, but it's not. all Jesus wants us to do is just to step out on faith, launch out into the deep, to show love, to show compassion, to be tenderhearted, trusting in the Savior. My brothers and sisters, as I stand back myself and ponder this wonderful miracle in Matthew chapter 14, and which is in all the Gospels, one truth seems to stand out above all the rest. If you like, you could call this a type of moral story. But God often puts us in situations where we are doomed to failure And when he puts us in them situations, what he's doing is making us learn to depend on him. I remember a time that I was in my house putting a floor in the basement, knowing that I have no carpentry talents. I would stand there and look at all those different types of tiles that I had to put down in the basement. And I would look at those tiles, and I know I didn't know how to cut different angles. And I would cry out to God, say, God, I know that all things are possible with you. I know that we don't have the money to get that basement taken care of. God, take my meager resources, take the incompetence of my mind, take the incompetence of my hand, and make them from ordinary to extraordinary. God, help me to put a floor down in that basement, and we didn't have to pay one single dime. All it took was some blood, sweat, and tears. My brothers and sisters, God is a God of possibilities. My brothers and sisters, as I prepare to close for real, I want to remind you of a few things. Jesus said in verse 27, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. In other words, God can do the impossible. He can't do the impossible. He can't do the possible with our own abilities, even if we feel unable or inadequate. He took a man named Moses, and Moses waved his hand and he parted the Red Sea. He took a young boy named David who defeated Goliath. He took a son named Jesus who was crucified on the cross for our sins, and we defeated death. My brothers and sisters, I stopped by to tell you, nothing is impossible with God. He can exchange the impossible, unthinkable, unfathomable, anything. All things are possible with God. I stopped by to tell you, my brothers and sisters, we didn't come this far by chance. We came this far by faith, leaning and trusting on the Lord. May God bless you, may God keep you, and may his grace smile upon you in Jesus' name. My brothers and sisters, the invitation to discipleship is now before you. You have a great opportunity to make Jesus Christ your Lord and your Savior. All you have to do is repeat after me and say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Come into my heart. I make you my Lord and my Savior. My brothers and sisters, if you have said those words, you are now Christians and children of Almighty God. Now, as we continue in worship, we will now prepare our hearts and mind for the great communion. Let's prepare our hearts and mind as prepare to receive the sacraments. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name by joining in this unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He broke it, and he gave thanks. And he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of those, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Now, brothers and sisters, with the confidence of the children of God, let us repeat the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forevermore. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, my brothers and sisters, you have your own sacraments of bread. This is the body of Christ that was given for you. You may take now and eat. This is the cup which was poured out for the remission of your sins. You may take now and drink. Now, my brothers and sisters, let us go forth in grace. Let us go forth in love. Let us pray. Go forth in peace. In the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. May God bless you, may God keep you, may you have a good week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Nehemiah 8 and 6, and Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen. Amen. Lifting up their hands, they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. When we receive a word from the Lord, our answer should be Amen. Let the church say Amen. Let the church say Amen. Let the church say Amen. God has spoken, so let the church say Amen. Yeah. Let the church, let them say Amen. If you believe the word, let the whole church say Amen. God has spoken, so let the church say Amen. Lift your hands, lift your hands. God has spoken, so let the church say Amen. Oh, thank you, Lord. God has spoken, so let the church say